Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Ultimate Fighting Championship, Part 2. Once again, there are no rules. Last year, the Ultimate Fighting Championship rocked the martial arts world. Champions from 8 different styles fought in no-holds-barred combat. There were no weight divisions, no gloves or pads, no time limits, and no scorecards. The rules were simple. 2 men enter, 1 man leaves. Anyone doubting that claim was quickly convinced as speed and accuracy confronted mass and power. A slip of the foot could cost a fighter victory, not to mention an eye or a tooth.
What did you expect going in? What do you expect now?
He punched out.
What was your strategy?
Let him hit me.
Some were unprepared for this type of anything-goes match and couldn't adapt to the rhythms and techniques. Champions accustomed to particular range were forced to alter their strategies. Unexpected shifts left them vulnerable to sudden reversals and painful defeat. In the Ultimate Fighting Championship, the sharpshooter brought down the giant and then hammered him into submission. Strength did not guarantee success. Like dueling chess masters, the victor was the one who could think 2 moves ahead.
I was thinking too much about getting a leg, not enough about worrying about my neck.
It looked like you did have supremacy early on, and then suddenly it reversed like lightning.
That's the way submission is.
There was no room for paper tigers.
If the fight goes longer than 1 round, I think there's something wrong with the way that people are fighting. This is real deal. This isn't boxing.
After 2 hours of grueling combat, 2 battle-weary masters squared off in the final test. No quarter asked, none given. Combat distilled in its most basic equation, survival or destruction. In the end, it was Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu master Royce Gracie standing triumphant in the center of the ring. And tonight, he returns to defend his title in a battle of 16 world-class martial arts masters. If you thought he had it rough last time, you ain't seen nothing yet.
What are you gonna do with the money?
I'm gonna go to Disneyland.
You going to Disneyland? Hello, everyone, and welcome to Mammoth Gordon's, right back here in Denver, Colorado, for Ultimate Fighting Championship 2, or Part 2. Hi, everyone, I'm Brian Kilmeade, joining you again like I was here in November. This time, I have a chance to sit down and talk to you. For those joining us for the first time, let me just inform you, welcome you officially. And for those here for the second time, let me tell you about some subtle changes this time around. Number one, instead of 8 fighters, we have 16 fighters. Number two, there is no 2. Round 2, that is. No round 2, no round 3, no round 4. There wasn't last time. This time, don't wait for a bell. We're just going to have 1 round. We're going to go right through. And again, as usual, there will be no rules. Joining us once again and joining me, I'm very fortunate to have next to me, and call him a friend, Jim Brown, sitting here in the broadcast booth. Jim, how do you feel about being here the second time
around? Well, Brian, I'm very happy to be here. I'm glad to say hello to the audience out there. People are talking about the violence of this particular sport. Yes, it is violent, but you have a lot of action, excitement, and science. If you don't know your skills, don't get out here. If you don't know how to fight on the floor, don't come out here, people.
This guy was up at 4 o'clock in the morning doing Good Morning America. It's amazing he's still awake. But Jim, thanks for joining us, and thanks for letting me sit next to you. Joining us, we're very fortunate to have someone who's very schooled in the martial arts and in Hollywood. Ben Perry, famed Hollywood stuntman. And Ben, you are the man when it comes to the expertise, because you've done this your whole life and you seem to thrive on it.
Well, if you came for action, folks, you came to the right spot. It's the age-old question, what style's the best? I think it gets down to, Brian, who's the toughest person tonight? And it could be, and you've always heard all your life, if you think you're the toughest guy in the world, there's always someone out there just a little bit tougher. Well, I think that guy is here tonight, Royce Gracie, defending his title against some unbelievable competition.
Yeah, I don't know how this event is going to turn out. I don't think anyone does. One thing we do know is where it will take place, and that'll be in the ring. But I use that term loosely because it's not a ring at all, is it, Herb Perez? 1992 Taekwondo Olympic gold medalist.
Well, Brian, you're right. It's not a ring, really. It's an octagon. And in this octagon, we've had a lot of matches tonight. We have a lot more to come. Reason we picked an octagon, it's not going to favor any style, anybody. It's going to be fair in here. Also, we made the floor just a bit quicker so that the kickers and punchers will be on equal footing with the grapplers. Thanks, Brian.
It's a very unique thing. If you're looking at that octagon and saying, I've never seen anything like it, you're absolutely right. The last time you saw it was back in November. It hasn't been used since. You talk about the first match, the last match we have coming up of the preliminary round, but we saw 7 bouts already. That's why I'm so keyed up. So please excuse me. Let's go over some of the results. You have a karate against an exotic, Doherty against Morris, and you have Scott Morris coming out on top.
Scott Morris is the ninja. We didn't know a whole lot on him because he is a ninja, so that speaks for itself.
Pat Smith, Ray Wizard, kickboxer against a karate master. Pat Smith, who was here in November, lost his first match, must have learned something because he advances to face Scott Morris. You have David Levecki against Johnny Rhodes, kung fu against karate. And Jim, talk about endurance. Johnny Rhodes showed it.
Oh, yes, he had tremendous endurance. I mean, it was a great fight.
Yeah, it was a great fight. 39 years old. Jim loves the older guys who do well. You getting the theme here?
Yes.
Yes. And you talk about Frank Hammaker. Did I skip ahead? No, I didn't. Frank Hammaker and Thaddeus Luster. Thaddeus Luster, we love his name, but he is out of the competition because Hammaker emerges victorious from Holland. Orlando Veit, not Wheat, against Robert Lucarelli. Well, it looked like two kickboxers against each other. We thought we'd see that. We didn't. Orlando Veit comes out victorious. Fell behind early on. Alberto Sierra Leone, possibly the enigma of this entire event. Well, he lost now. He goes down to Remco Pardo, a very humble guy, a man who told Jim Brown, I don't even know how I'm going to do. I'm a little scared, a little nervous. He didn't look it. Scott Baker against Jason DeLucia. It's a match we just saw two kung fu experts take on each other. A great match, possibly the most strategy we've seen in both Ultimate Fighting Championships. Jason DeLucia emerges victorious. And that brings us up to our current bout, and you are now updated and saw what we have seen for the last 2 hours. 7 preliminary bouts. You remember I told you about 16 people? 8 bouts. Here is the 8th. And here are the styles, because when you talk about this event, you talk more than two individuals. You talk about styles. You have the Karate Man, of course, from Japan, and you have Hoist Gracie, last year's champion, the ultimate grappler, the quintessential grappler, and right now, Minoki Ishihara, a man who brought the Japanese press with him, a man who brought his own entourage, a man who many thought would get to the finals. However, he's got Hoist Gracie. Here is Ishihara as he makes his way towards the ring. Talk about focus. That's a focus, man.
He has the focus. He's a strong guy. He's noted for his quick reverse punches, thrust punches, counter punches. He's going to need that tonight.
Yeah, he's actually smaller than Hoist Gracie, who was the smallest one in the competition. He's 5'8". So here's a profile on the man from Japan we don't know much about.
In his hometown of Tokyo, Japan, Ninoki Ichihara is a living legend. A second-degree black belt in Karate-do Daedo-juku, Minoki has won more than 60 full-contact fights in his career. At only 5'7" and 178 pounds, he is the smallest competitor in the Ultimate Fighting Championship, but he is not concerned.
Maybe my body may be small, but my spirit is big. I can win.
Minoki says Chinese kung fu movies inspired him as a boy to learn the martial arts.
I like those heroes, and I hope to be strong like them.
If you ask Minoki why he entered the Ultimate Fighting Championship, he'll give you a very direct answer.
I saw Hoist Gracie win last year. He looked dangerous. I thought to myself, I would like to fight this dangerous man.
Make no mistake about it, Minoki Ichihara has come to fight.
Maybe he didn't want to fight that most dangerous man in the preliminary round, but he didn't have a choice. It's a random draw. And the man we're about to see, a man about to be introduced, a man that a lot of people are here to see and amazed with in Ultimate Fighting 1, he is the reigning champion. He is Hoist Gracie, led by the whole Gracie clan. Each one of them tremendous fighters, Ben. You know this firsthand.
Unbelievable. I've been training with Hoist for quite some time. He's just a master technician on the ground. He has the best defense, which is incredible against any comers. He's been training against 600, 700-pound guys. Check this guy out.
Yeah, I tell you, this has got a championship feel to it, and it's still a preliminary round. And there he is. And here is Hoist Gracie talking about defending his title and why he's here.
Hi, I'm Hoist Gracie, and I'm 4-degree black belt in Gracie Jiu-Jitsu, and I'm the current champion, and I'm here to defend my title.
And defend his title he will. Let's go to Rich Goins for the formal introduction. G-Man.
Ladies and gentlemen, Denver, Colorado welcomes the nation to the Ultimate Fighting Championship Part 2 at the Mammoth Event Center. Please welcome the contestants, for bout number 8 of our preliminary fight matchups. A national hero in Japan, fighting out of the red corner, this second degree black belt in karate, Daido Jeku, is the winner of more than 60 full contact matches. Although only 5'7 and 178 pounds, he has the heart of a giant. Give a big American welcome to Minoki Ichihara. Ichihara. And please welcome back the Rio de Janeiro native, a fourth degree black master in the art of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. 6'1", 176 pounds, he's 27 years old, the winner of last year's Ultimate Fighting Championship and $50,000. Welcome back from Brazil, Royce Gracie! Gracie! Good luck, gentlemen.
All right, we're gonna go take a look at both fighters right now. They are sizing each other up. Minoki Ichihara, 5'7", 178, heavy guy, not that tall. Royce Gracie, 6'1", 176, and they're about to engage.
Royce is gonna wanna go to a clinch quickly. He does not wanna get hit. And the reverse punches and thrust punches are really strong from Ichihara.
Is Ichihara in trouble if he's on the ground?
Oh, definitely. Definitely.
And he's down.
Yes, he is.
He's down on the ground.
Yes. Watch the horse. He'll take his left leg and go over the top. There it is. He'll get him in a hook position. Now he'll rest. He'll get a good mounted base. And he'll just rest. He'll get his hand over to block that.
Jim, this look familiar?
Yes, it does.
He may end it up too quickly. What he'll do is he will grind this into his face and neck. And Ichihara will release that left hand just like that.
Hey, wait a second. Did we script this for this guy? Do you think he studies the Gracie Jiu-Jitsu or just lucked out?
Sorry,
that's my instructor over there.
Sorry about that.
How is he playing into his hands?
Oh, he'll just keep hitting him until he lets go.
Are they hurting punches?
Oh, sure. They're right into the ribs. Ichihara will let go. He'll let go. Now he'll palm strike him a little bit to the side. There it is, to the side of the head.
How unfamiliar is this to Ichihara, being on the ground, being in an inferior position?
I'm not sure. I don't have that data on Ichihara, but right now he's in a very vulnerable position.
You just had to be at the press conference when these two were paired up in the preliminary round. You heard the oohs and ahs.
Yes, the whole room oohed and ahed.
The way we understand it, this easily could have been the finals.
Yes.
Now
that's what he's trying to do, is get that elbow just to get over the side. Now he's going to push his head over. Royce will take his left hand and hold the side of his head. He'll just work him over, hopefully. He may go to an arm lock or an arm bar. Royce does not want to win this with an arm lock.
What?
He wants to win this with a choke.
You mean he cares how he wins?
Oh, certainly, certainly. He doesn't want to win this with an arm lock. He will if he's losing endurance or if he's having a problem getting the guy in anything else. He will do that. But he's really, if I know Royce, he's going to go for the choke. More dramatic.
You got to think about the emotions going in. He won't talk about it, but he's representing the whole Gracie family as a member. He loses. I mean, he's got the whole family to face and to live up to, and that whole name.
I think so, too. In this particular position that Royce is in, I don't think he's going to lose this match. He's rolling him over on the side now, and he'll go for the choke. Ichihara has a good lock on that shoulder, though.
Really?
Yeah. But that's okay. Royce is in good position.
Why?
Because he stays on you just like a crab or an anaconda. He gives you no space to get up or move. All of his weight is on him. He'll headbutt him, he'll maneuver him. Now you'll see Hickson, Hoyler, Royce, Hoker, all of his brothers are right in front of him. That's the whole Jiu-Jitsu clan just talking to him right now. I guarantee you, Royce is not using any energy right now, hardly at all.
You watch Hickson right there in the guru. He's being blocked right now, but Hickson is the guru. He's the man that Royce looks up to.
That's correct.
The man that really does a lot of training with Royce.
That's correct. And after training with Hickson all this time, Royce says anything will be a welcome change.
Yeah, one of his quotes. Yeah. See the whole Gracie family there.
Yes. That's Horion. They're just on, Lord from Horion.
And again, it's not Gracie Jiu-Jitsu by mistake. It just isn't a coincidence. They invented this art.
They perfected their style of Jiu-Jitsu. Originally came from Japan.
How different is it from anything we've seen in other Jiu-Jitsu? Tremendous amount?
I personally think tremendously amount because of the finishing holes and how technical they are. And they'll just wear the opponent down and wear the opponent down. Ichihara is in a tough position to be in right now.
Is Ichihara expending a lot of energy?
Oh, definitely, definitely.
Just laying there.
Because not only is he on the bottom, He doesn't want to be on the bottom because Hoist has him in a mounted position. And anytime he tries to roll or get up or move, he exerts all this energy. Hoist is just taking his time.
This is a lot longer, Jim, than we remember last time.
That's a shot on Hoyler, the smallest of the Gracie. Now also, anytime Ichihara will move or roll or try to get over, Hoist will just go with him on top of him like a little crab. He'll just stay right on top of him. Hoist can crank this up at any minute he wants to. He can dictate this fight. See how he's moving? And Hoist just stays on him just like a crab.
Inoki Ishihara says his best punch, his best best weapon is the lunge punch.
That's
not going to help him.
Lunge punch is a real strong technique using the reverse hand. If you're standing with your left foot in front and you throw a reverse punch, it would be your right hand coming forward. Real strong technique.
And Hoist see Ishihara again showing more life.
Hoist is really, really punishing Ichihara right now.
Man, you talk about a game face. Hoist has it.
He does. He does. Hoist is probably going to want to end this up pretty quickly now. He doesn't want to sit. Well, he could do an arm lock real easily right now, but I think he's going to let him turn and go for the choke. Here it is.
He's letting him turn.
Yeah.
He poked.
Yeah, he tapped.
Was that an arm lock?
Over. Yes. No, no. I think he choked him out. I couldn't tell. Oh, he did. Yeah. Arm lock.
It looked like an arm lock.
He probably broke his arm.
You think that arm could be broken?
I knew he was going to finish it pretty quick because he doesn't want to spend all this energy because he has other fights.
That was close to a five-minute fight.
He probably popped a capsule in his arm. I couldn't really tell from this angle. Okay, he has him in a choke. He has him in a choke. That's not working. Ishihara is slipping out. Let me see if I can see what he's doing here. He reaches. Oh, he gives him his arm, goes in an arm lock. Watch him raise his hips. And yes.
Okay.
Right there.
All right.
Yes.
See, the crowd was responding to the reversal in Fortune.
Yes.
With it looked like Hoist was being dominated, but you said no.
It's just leverage, yes. Absolute leverage.
Defending champion defends his title. That's exactly what he did.
I thought that would happen. If Hoist is going on, the fight's dragging on, then he will end it.
Yeah, it was unbelievable. I'll tell you, to Ichihara's credit, he was the one who kept going. Ichihara kept him for 5 minutes.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. But Hoist dictated the fight the whole time. He was on top of him in a very good base, had his feet hooked underneath, and he was just very stable. And Ichihara exposed his arm. Hoist says, I don't want to stay here any longer. I'll take it. That's fine. Right. End of story.
For a technician, there's no need to rush.
Yes.
But I'll tell
no
you.
No need to hurry up.
But Jim, we talked about that other factor, and again, we talk about expending energy. But the other factor is, hey, it's a preliminary round. Get in, get out. 16 fighters
well,
now.
It's not
extra
always
practice.
That easy.
Yeah.
Jim's a technician. He rushed for about 5 million yards. What's the deal here?
And never did hurry it up.
Okay. Know what I like to do now? I like to go back and show you out there, you viewers, what you missed. All right. We have Sean Dougherty losing to Scott Morris. We have the advancer there. Now we have an announcement for you, Rhodes Hammaker. Hammaker came out on top.
Yes,
now,
he did.
Hammaker will not fight. We understand he's been injured. We're not sure what that injury is, but we do have alternates just in case something like this happened, and that, of course, goes to Fred Edish from Minnesota. We don't know much about him, fifth-degree black belt, and this looks like a Chinese word I've never seen before. Can you pronounce that?
Oh, Shoenryu, you mean is the style of
Shoenryu,
yes.
What can you tell us about that?
Well, it's a Japanese style, and we don't know much, like we said, about this gentleman, but because he is an alternate, he will not have to face the wrath of being winded from the first fight, so we'll see how that goes.
Okay, we talked about this great fight. It lasted close to 12 minutes, possibly even longer. Levecki against Rhodes, and we're going to go take a look at it now. The bigger man suffers a very surprising fate, at least as far as I was concerned. This is the end of the fight.
This was a grueling fight. It looks a lot worse than it is, folks. It gets a little grueling here because of the headbutt opened up the eye just below the eye, above the cheekbone there. It was bone on bone, and you can see the blood coming out.
See, what you have to understand at home is they were in that position for about 10 minutes. 10 minutes, and the endurance of a 6'5", 290-pound man, David Levecki, was really tested, and unfortunately that blow just ended any type of endurance contest. Now we'd like to go to Robert Lucarelli and Orlando Veit, and this was supposed to be a classical kickboxing match. That's what I thought. Jim didn't didn't think that. And,
no, I didn't.
Did you really?
I didn't.
Oh, you didn't. Orlando Beat, possibly the best conditioned athlete I've ever seen in person.
What a specimen. He broke this takedown, broke this hole. That's what ended the fight right there, that knee to the face. And we thought the guy tapped, but he didn't tap in the round kick. Then he comes in and really finishes him off. He realizes the fight's not over. He turns around. This guy is an awesome specimen. Check this out. He comes back. The guy tries to protect himself. Whang, he misses him here. Now watch this crushing elbow to the back. Oh, devastating power. This guy is something to watch.
Keep in mind, too, that Robert Lucarelli didn't even quit. His corner threw in the towel, and I'm glad they did. I'll tell you, that guy's got tremendous guts.
Well,
that's
a
whole different element.
Quit. I don't think he was in a state of mind. Yeah. He really knew what was happening.
Definitely.
Okay. I'll bow to you guys on that one. And right here is the towel throw.
They had to pull this guy off him. They really did.
And what's also amazing is they'll hug each other after. And now the match you just saw, Hoist Gracie, the defending champion, against Minoki Ichihara, a match that we were looking forward to. A lot of Japanese were also. It's and like, here is the closing of that match.
Like we said, I couldn't see it. I thought he had him in a choke, but it was hard to tell. But because of the leverage of the elbow, he popped the arm there.
Yeah. And he was also holding his face right after. So Hoist Gracie, you know, you called it exactly, Bennett. It's so obvious how well schooled you are on all the fighters. But Hoist was really in control, where if I was sitting here without an expert next to me, I would think that Hoist was really losing control when actually he was having a play into his hands.
We would have never understood the tap.
Yeah.
Not at all.
It was lightning fast.
I couldn't see it. I didn't think he would tap before his arm was extended. That's what was different to me. Usually the arm is extended and completely locked in. It's locked into place and it's hyperextended. That's why you tap. And you can't really get out of that technique once it's locked in and the thumb is in the upward position.
You know, one of the things we like to talk about, as well as the fighters in their history, is the discipline they study. It'll help you at home understand more about what you're seeing and appreciate it. So let's take a look at some of the five family of disciplines and some of those, some of the details.
Karate developed to maturity in Okinawa. Karate means empty hand. Today, the term karate has become a generic term for countless styles throughout Okinawa, Japan, and Korea. Karate is recognized for its powerful stances and dynamic strikes. Its punches and kicks are delivered on direct, angular lines with explosive force. Designed to be a method of peasant empty-hand defense against a samurai sword, karate taught its students to focus their concentration upon a single attack, one blow, one kill. Boards and bricks, shattered by the karate master, demonstrate the power being unleashed. Easily the most popular fighting art in the world, karate is practiced by millions. Kickboxing is a blend of Western boxing and karate. Make no mistake, Western boxing is a science, referred to as the sweet science by ex-heavyweight champ Muhammad Ali. Western boxing is known for its rapid-fire combinations. These combinations, in conjunction with elusive footwork, make a deceptively lethal style. After exposure to boxing, martial artists began incorporating the hand techniques into their arsenal. Some boxers began to add kicking. While similar to their karate origins, the kickboxer's leg attacks favored combinations, making it more compatible with his punching. The kickboxer trains in the gym just like the regular boxers, using the heavy bag, focus mitts, shadow boxing, and endless rounds of sparring to sharpen his skills. Road work and rope skipping ensure endurance, and the full contact sparring conditions them against the pain. The kickboxer's motto, don't dance, just get the job done. Kung Fu dates back to the famous Shaolin Temple in China. Legend states it that Dharma, the founder of Buddhism, first taught sleepy monks exercises to build their endurance for meditation. These exercises later developed into what is now known as Shaolin Kung Fu. The Shaolin styles drew their inspiration from the movements of the five animals: the tiger, the crane, the snake, the praying mantis, and the mythical dragon. Each animal offered a different theory of attack and defense. Kung Fu is noted for its elusive and supple attacks. Kung Fu fighter seeks to avoid or deflect an attack rather than squarely blocking it. Sophisticated and deadly, Kung Fu has earned the title Father of the Martial Arts. Grappling and wrestling skills appear in the history of nearly every nation. Greco-Roman wrestling can be traced back to the days of pancration and gladiator combat. These contests were brutal, often leaving the winner crippled for life. The loser died. In Japan, the samurai developed jujitsu, a system of throwing and joint manipulation techniques designed to deal with the armored enemy on the battlefield. Russia is the home of sambo, a synthesis of jujitsu and Greco-Roman grappling. Sambo offers its practitioners a happy marriage of intricacy and sweeping power. In reality, grappling is a sophisticated and subtle art. The grappler emphasizes close quarter combat. His principal techniques are chokes and joint manipulations. He can render a man unconscious by blocking the oxygen to his brain or immobilize him by breaking the connective joints. Fighting a skilled grappler is like trying to punch your way out of an octopus's grip. During the period of the shogunate in Japan, political intrigue and espionage played a crucial role among the feudal lords. It was the era of the spy and assassin. Thus, the ninja clans were born. The term ninjutsu means art of the shadow warrior. Because so much of ninjutsu work requires stealth and secrecy, he learned to kill with speed and silence. Indonesia is the home of the art of pensak salat. Pensak salat was initially passed down privately from father to son. Some scholars believe that salat may actually predate kung fu in origin. They claim that when the Dharma arrived in China, he brought with him skills learned in India, Burma, and Indonesia. A salat fighter will control his enemy's limbs, directing him into a continuous barrage of strikes and trapping sweeps.
Yeah, we're back live here in Denver, Colorado, having a great time, just like we were in the first one. Some really intriguing matches. It's hard to believe, and the more experts we talk to, the more we're backed up by this. This is really more of a chess match than anyone understands.
Oh, it really is. I mean, we're so lucky to have Ben with us to call those shots before they happen. You know, I worked out with him, and I mean, really, when I came out, I had so much respect for the sport.
Yeah, you have so much for the sport. I don't know if you caught that before, but Ben anticipated every move that Gracie's made, and I wouldn't be surprised if Ben tries to jump in the ring for Ultimate Fighting 3. Ben, could we?
No. I'm subscribing now to a magazine, Duh Magazine, so I'm not going to be doing that.
All right, now it's time for a look at the disciplines and the match we're about to see as we move into the quarterfinals. It is kickboxing versus an exotic, and a lot of people don't know what exotic is. You should now. You just got to look at it. How would you define that?
Exotics are anything that's not your normal karate system.
And right now, it's time to look at Scott Morris. Scott Morris won his earlier match, beating Sean Doherty with very little energy. And I'll tell you, Jim, you mentioned this before, the endurance factor. Scott just pumped him right out.
Yeah, he's coming real fresh, real fresh.
If he can protect his neck, when they go to the ground, he's a tough guy. He was a lot tougher than I thought he'd be in the first shot.
And, you know, you got to wonder what was going through his mind early on, because it was his first real match.
Yes.
And here's Scott talking about advancing in this competition.
Hi, I'm Scott Morris, representing Robert Bussey's Warrior International in the Ultimate Fighting Championship, and we came to win.
And came to win he did, at least his first match so far. He represents the Robert Bussey. He'll be getting an award possibly a little bit later on, a great man in his own right. And now it's time for Pat Smith, the man who's back for the second time at this event, but for the first time he won, so he advances. Pat Smith is also a professional boxer.
We know about Pat. He's been around a long time. As I said before, he's had over 200 and something wins to his career. It's a phenomenal record. And a tough guy, ground grappler, really strong kicker, inside guy, came with the mind, brought it all tonight.
Is it possible to look relaxed when you're going into a fight like this? Because if so, I think Pat is.
I think so. After the fights get the first couple fights, no. But I think as the fights go on, I think they start getting into it.
Oh, you really think they can be relaxed?
So again, yeah. Here's Pat Smith that came back again. He's determined to win it all, and he talked about that emotion.
My name is Patrick Smith. Ranked fifth in the world by WKC. Just won the 1993 Heavyweight Sabaki Challenge. That's why I think I'm going to win this competition.
Quarterfinal one about to get underway, and to do that, as you see him make his way into the ring, is G-Man Rich Goins with the fighter introductions. Rich.
Ladies and gentlemen, our first quarterfinal match of the Ultimate Fighting Championships from the Mammoth Event Center in Denver, Colorado. Please welcome our contestants. First, fighting out of the blue or the red corner, from Robert Bussey's Warriors International, in advanced status, black belt in the art of American Ninjutsu, 6 foot, 208 pounds, a native of Arlington, Texas. He is proud to represent his teacher and organization. Ladies and gentlemen, Scott Morris.
Tough guy.
I would say so.
And his opponent, a black belt in Taekwondo, Tang Sudo and Hapkido, 6 foot two, 220 pounds, the winner of the 1993 Sabaki Challenge. He is returning to the octagon for his second straight attempt at the title. Please welcome Denver native, Patrick Smith.
Patrick Smith, glad to be here. The crowd glad he is still alive in this tournament. They have their hometown boy, and he is as relaxed as any man I've ever seen in the octagon. And here is the tale of the tape. Scott Morris, 6 foot, 208 pounds. Pat Smith, about the same dimension, 6'2", 219. But all the training, it all comes down to this.
Pat is a strong, strong man, even though he just stood there when he came to him. Big takedown there.
Look at this. He's going to break the hold by punching himself out of it.
That's a really tough position for Scott to be in. Really tough. His corner will probably throw the towel in on this one. It's over.
Whoa.
That's intense, folks.
That is intense.
Whoa. That's what it's all about.
And I'll tell you, throw is over.
Yeah. Oh, boy. That was over fast.
That was fast and brutal.
Really intense. Elbows are the second toughest bones.
Here is Pat Smith. We're going to go to a post-fight interview. Take it, Herb.
Okay, Pat, that was a great fight, nice and quick. What did you expect in that?
Up. Last time Cameron Shamrock got a hold on me that I didn't know how to get out of. Same thing would have happened to him. I've been working on my ground fighting just a little bit. Not like I should.
Well, that was terrific. What do you expect for your next game? What do you expect?
The big guy don't, he's a submit holder. He puts all his weight on you. He's gonna mess up and try to take me down like he did. He's gonna throw him off balance. I'll be right on top of him, I'm gonna pound him.
All right, Pat, good luck.
Back to you, bud. Yeah, thank you very much, Herb. Got a chance to see Pat Smith, and we're gonna take another look at the replay. Here's Pat Smith saying, throw in the towel, because I don't even know officially that this is over.
Guy can't even stand up. This guy can't even get up. You know, how tough was that?
Yeah, I'll tell you, what are you thinking right now if you're watching this and you know you have a chance of facing this guy that just took out Scott?
Well, it's going to go to the ground, that's for sure. And what Scott did is he gave him leverage. When Scott was on the ground, he should have reached up and grabbed him around the neck to hold him close to him so that Pat could not get up to give him leverage and punching power.
We move on to the quarterfinals now. Before we get to the fighters, as usual, we like to introduce the disciplines. And they're very alike. They're the same. Karate versus karate. And you talk about Johnny Rhodes. And you talk about a man that was a last-minute alternate, Fred Edish. Fred Edish comes in for an injured Frank Hamaker. And right now, we're taking a look at Johnny Rhodes, 39 years old, and he was in the longest bout in the history of Ultimate Fighting, and that was close to, what, 15, 16 minutes?
Well, that's something to tell your grandkids. I was in the longest bout in the history of the Ultimate Fighting Challenge, so if nothing else, he did that, so he's in the record book.
Well, he did it, but I'm not sure how much it took out of him.
Yes.
Yeah. You know what else, Jim? We have a last-minute substitution in this bracket of the quarterfinals. This man has not fought yet, and even if he isn't as skilled as, Frank Hamaker, who was hurt, he's fresh. And right now, it's time for our first look at Fred Edish, an alternate in, as I mentioned, for Fred Hamaker of Holland. And here is Fred Edish as we get a look at him. 53 black belt, as I mentioned before. He's here because I have absolute faith in my system of Kenpo. And what does Kenpo mean for grappling?
Well, it doesn't mean much for grappling. It means a lot for power kicks and inside tough punching. But Shorenroof is his style, and we'll check it out.
All right, and I'll tell you what, Johnny Rose, what did he show you in the first one, and what did he really prove to you at 39 years old?
Well, he's got two things going against him the way I see it. He has the long fight that he was winded on, and he's going against a fresh competitor. However, he does outweigh the guy. Let's just see. I hope he takes it to a good fight here. I hope that the odds aren't too stacked against him.
It's time to go to the G-Man in the ring.
Ladies and gentlemen, our second quarterfinal match pits two great champions. Give them a warm Denver welcome. Fighting out of the red corner from Las Vegas, Nevada, fourth degree black belt in Shorinjiru Karate, the winner of dozens of national karate championships, and the former Nevada State heavyweight kickboxing champion, 6 foot and 210 pound, Johnny Rhodes. And ladies and gentlemen, we have an alternate for the second quarterfinal match. He replaces Frank Homaker, who withdrew with an arm injury. This gentleman is a fifth degree black belt in the art of Shorin Irimatsu Moran Kempo. Fighting out of the blue corner, he comes from Minnesota, 6 foot and 180 pounds. Give it warm Denver welcome to Fred Edish. Edish.
Sometimes these last-minute entrants can give you a tough time. Sometimes they can be unorthodox, and we'll see what happens here.
Hey, Jim, Fred Edish, very fortunate. He comes into this tournament in the quarterfinals.
Maybe.
I know what you're saying.
We're getting mighty close. There's a zone there that they have to contend with, and that's that distance just between the fighters before they make the initial move.
Now, was Johnny one who initiated the ground play last time, the grappling?
We may see some techniques here. May not go to the ground yet.
If you get the close-up, you can see Johnny's eyes. So intense.
That straight right hand is going to come into play here. You'll see counter-punching from Johnny Rhodes. There it is.
There it is. Kurt.
That straight right hand. He'll let him get up and try to kick him. Here we go.
So Fred's got to get up.
Well, he'll try to get up, but he should put his left hand behind him and scoot up with his left leg. You shouldn't get up facing forward. You should get up going backwards so you can protect yourself if the guy comes in.
The only man I've seen get up from this position was Jason DeLucia in the preliminary.
Yes, he did it correctly.
Oh, whoa. That punch by Johnny Rhodes has opened up a cut on Fred Edish like I've never seen one punch do.
Yes, this fight's over. It's a matter of time here. And again, it looks a lot worse than it is.
What guts on Fred Edish?
He has a cut just above his eye.
Still. Does Johnny want to avoid getting down with him?
Well, I think the corner should just recognize what's going on here.
2.5 minutes old. Yeah, it's pointing to his eye.
It's the will of the fighter. There's no question. You see a big mouse up there above the eye.
I think Johnny showed some empathy again in his early fight against Levicki. He's showing it here.
Yeah, it's very difficult for him to see. That's why he keeps shaking his head.
Now, is Rhodes seeing openings but deciding not to go in?
Well, it's very difficult. He doesn't know ground grappling, so if someone is on the ground and they're kicking at you like that, it's fine. You just cover up, you grab the leg, and you go for a mounted position.
And now this is a familiar
exactly
position.
What he did. Now he has all the leverage to punch. If he knew the choke, he'd go for the choke here. Got his left hand in place. His right arm should just go right behind the head, and that'll choke him out.
Can't say enough about Fred Edish taking this kind of pain.
Yes, yes. It's very difficult for him to see. The bad cuts are above the eye.
You know, Ben, it's amazing that they would not learn those choke holds.
I know, isn't it? It really is.
It was right there.
Yeah, I agree with you.
I mean, I could have.
Here he goes. Here, he's got him in the left hand in place. He can choke him out with one arm, by the way. He'll probably tap now, because one arm is all it takes. He just has to close that together.
And Fred's energy really seems sucked out of this point.
Yeah, definitely.
And he knocked out his mouthpiece. He's done everything except tap out.
Yeah, if he rolls over on his stomach, then it's really going to close that choke into a...
How do you get out? Ben, how do you
break
this?
Well, you just protect your neck. You just reach up, shoot one hand underneath the elbow so that you... It takes both sides of the neck to be choked out. So the other... Johnny isn't closing the choke. It's over.
Again, it's over. Johnny Rhodes truly impressing everyone here.
That was very impressive.
Oh, yeah.
That was very impressive to come back after that long fight like that and do what he did.
Well, I think it was, but if you look at the size of this gentleman, and you deal with the fact that he's a kicker.
Yes.
It really wasn't.
Exactly.
But so good.
Fred Eddish, he comes in as an alternate. He doesn't know what to expect. He's in the quarterfinals against a guy that just crushed a man 6'5". And David, he sits in there. Fred Eddish does to his credit.
See, that counterpunching is really tough because as soon as you expose yourself by giving a kick like that, you're leaving yourself open for a counterpunch. So all what Johnny did is step back when he tried to throw a kick, and he came with a straight right hand. Now it's just a matter of time. He really hurt this guy.
You want to hear from Johnny Rhodes? All right, let's go to Johnny Rhodes right now. Herb.
Okay, Johnny, it was a great fight, great fight. The guy wouldn't give up. What'd you think about that?
Well, he's a tough guy. It's a lot of good, great competitors here. You don't want to embarrass yourself. You want to hang in as long as you can.
Johnny, you got a lot of spirit. You had a lot of energy out there. What do you anticipate for the future?
Well, I'm 39 years old. I've boxed, I've kickboxed. I've done it all. And I wanted to try this.
What do you got planned for the next guy, Johnny?
Well, Pat's a tough fighter. He has a lot of weapons. But I plan on boxing him. Hopefully, let him get me on the ground.
All right, champ. Good luck. We'll see you later.
Time to move on now. We talk about two men who advanced to the quarterfinals. We have Orlando Vliet against Remco Pardo. And this is kickboxing against. Let's take a look at the disciplines. Kickboxing versus grappling. And not only, again, let's reemphasize, not only are you going in there representing your person yourself, you're representing your style and your discipline. It's time to go now to Orlando Vliet, who's once again, for the second time tonight, making his way through the smoke and making his way through the ring. Now, he didn't have that exhausting of a first fight.
No, he didn't. You know, great fight for him, but he's still a question mark with me.
What? Didn't only saw him 3 minutes.
This guy's fun to watch. He is really fun to watch. Talk about technique, power, quickness. He's got it all.
All right, here's Orlando.
I'm Orlando Vliet, Muay Thai, Thai boxing world champion. We're gonna have some fun in the Ultimate Championship. See you. Hey, hey.
Here's another man back for some fun, advancing to the quarterfinals, Remco Pardo. A grappler. Jiu-jitsu is one of his specialties. Judo is another. This is a big man, 24 years old. According to Jim Brown, just a big kid.
He looks like a big kid. He's much bigger than his opponent, of course.
He's also from Holland, so Gerard Gardeau and the guys are with him, bringing him into the ring. And that was a very long fight that he fought earlier, so he's a bit winded, too. This may be a very quick fight here.
What would you say about getting the first fight out of the way in the preliminary rounds, knowing it's a victory? I would virtually eliminate nerves.
Yeah, I don't think that Remco has a chance here.
Here's Remco talking about this event.
Hello, I'm Remco Pardo from Holland. I'm Dutch Open, Open Belgium, Open German, Open Danish, and world champion in Jiu-Jitsu. I'm competing in this event to get the first prize.
Quarterfinals continue. To do that, Rich Goins with the fighter introductions.
Ladies and gentlemen, our third quarterfinal match tonight pits two more great champions in the Ultimate Fighting Championships, part two. Please welcome in the blue corner. He is from Oss, Holland, the current owner of the Dutch, Belgium, German, and Danish open class Jiu-Jitsu Championships. He weighs in at 260 pounds, 6'4". Please welcome Remco Pardo. And his opponent, a winner by knockout in his first match this evening, the Thai kickboxing world champion in 1993. He has an impressive record of 55-9, 13 by KO. He has dominated the world of Thai boxing for 7 years. Please welcome Orlando the Gladiator, Vliet.
He has made himself a favorite very early on, Orlando Vliet from France.
Not to take anything away from Remco, but he's a little bit winded, and he's the guy who was a little timid in there earlier and used that for his advantage, I think.
Orlando, much smaller, 5'10", 170. Remco, much heavier, much taller.
Look how Orlando covers up here. Fight sideways, he's a lesser target to hit.
He's got the whole Holland connection now with Frank Hamaker out of it in his corner. Whoa.
Same takedown that Remco used earlier.
Is it instinct now? Do you care where you are, Ben?
Well, I think he has to get over and get him in the mounted position and try to finish him. He goes for these arm locks and spends a lot of time doing it.
Orlando, it's hard for me to imagine him being in this position too many times in his straight-up career.
Orlando is so quick and so clever, I think he'll be out of this pretty soon. You'll notice Remco has all of his weight on him and holding onto that elbow. He doesn't want to put all of his weight too far over because Orlando can pull him over his body and then get him in a mounted position. He can just swing him over the top.
So what does Remco have to do?
Remco has to just try to keep the leverage on this side of him.
Again,
maybe a few elbows.
There he goes for the head.
Orlando is one strong man, though.
Is this strength here? Is this strength or is this technique?
This is both. This is both. Strong elbows to the
those
head.
Are hitting.
He's out.
He's out.
My goodness.
And that's it.
My goodness.
Wow.
How was that?
Remco
unexpected.
Advances.
What an absolute unexpected.
All right, let's go right now to the winner who advances to the semifinals, Remco.
Remco.
And there's Herb.
Remco, we saw you in the gym. You were a monster in the gym, calm. And here you were just as calm till you won. What do you attribute that to?
Yeah. I looked for my chance and I grabbed it.
You took a monster chance and you incapacitated your opponent. Did you expect that?
I didn't expect to win.
You didn't expect to win?
I thought he was a tough guy.
Okay, he was a tough guy, but maybe you were a tougher guy. What do you anticipate for your next match?
Try to win.
Remco, good luck. You did a terrific job. Back to you, Brian.
It's a man of few words, huh?
Yeah, a man of very few words. I didn't expect to win.
He said that yesterday. He says, I don't expect to win. I'm very timid and I'm very nervous right now. But he found himself in the right position, and look what happened. Had all the leverage. Unbelievable technique.
Yeah. It's unbelievable. So the technique of the ring card girls, I understand. But right now we're going to move on through the quarterfinals. You have Scott Baker, who lost, Jason DeLucia, and then you have, of course, Royce Gracie, last year's champ. Now it's time for a look at the disciplines before we get to a look at the fighters. So it's Kung Fu takes on grappling. And this is a fight that's been done before. It was about 2 years ago. And the man right now that took on Royce Gracie is making his way into the ring. He's Jason DeLucia. And Jason's coming in through the smoke. He looks so good. And Jim, I think you mentioned off camera what a tactician he was.
Yes, I think the fight was a great fight from the standpoint of the arts.
Yeah, and he beat Scott Baker to advance. What could he possibly have learned in those 2 years after they went down to the Gracie Academy and fought, where I think Jason didn't last more than 5 minutes, he told us.
Well, the more you learn the Gracie style, the more the Gracies continue to learn. So I don't know. I don't know how he stands a chance.
Here's Jason talking about his goals today.
Hi, I'm Jason DeLucia. I'm from Bellingham, Massachusetts. I'm a red sash in the Chinese Kung Fu Five Animal System, and I'm here to test myself in the Ultimate Fighting Championship.
And believe me, test himself he will against Royce Gracie, who's making his way into the ring with the whole Gracie clan. Keep in mind, these people all have just fought. And right now we go to the ring, to the smoke, the Royce Gracie and the whole Gracie family as they make their way into the ring, all of which seem as though they're all ready to fight.
Royce has not planned anything different for this fight opposed to any other fight. He has a strategy. He sticks to his strategy, his game plan, ground grappling. He's an absolute master. He can choke you out, put you to sleep faster than your grandmother can say once upon a time.
You know, all the Gracies have said they really respect Jason and what he's accomplished so far. They love his attitude. They love his willingness to learn other arts.
That means that they're going to get him out of there quick, huh?
I guess so. And there's his dad, the man. There's a ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, our final quarter match of the evening. At the Ultimate Fighting Championships Part 2, please welcome our two combatants out of the red corner. 5'11", 190 pounds. He is a holder of the red sash in Five Animal Kung Fu. He is the winner of 22 bare knuckle matches from Bellingham, Massachusetts, Jason DeLucia. DeLucia. And his opponent from Rio de Janeiro. 6'1", 176 pounds, 27 years old, the defending Ultimate Fighting Champion, Hoyce Gracie! Gracie!
What comes to mind when I watch Hoyce is the way he tries to stare down his opponent. He just stares and he freezes.
He's like a big cat. Big cat.
Jason again, Hoyce is used to this, a little bit bigger, 5'11", 190. Hoyce 6'1", 176, kind of slender.
Jason knew this would happen. Hoyce puts all of his weight on him, goes down in two, and now Jason is in Hoyce's guard, it's called.
What does that mean?
Hoyce has his legs wrapped around him. That's called in the guard. So now all Hoyce will do is slide out from his right side. He'll scoot out on the back, and he'll roll out on the side. He's just scooting now on the other side, you can see.
Jason has focused all his energy on beating Gracie. He knew he'd face him.
Yes.
I don't know about the quarterfinals.
Yes. He's got him in this. This is indicative of the earlier match. Tries to roll him over in his position here. Watch. Look how Hoyce's head is very close to Jason's head.
It seems that Gracie's have predictions of moves, two or three moves ahead.
Yes, they do. And if this doesn't work, they'll go to something else. It's a calculated thing.
I have to ask you something that still amazes me. Couldn't that gi be used against you? Couldn't it be pulled over your head reminiscent of a hockey fight?
It can, but usually if it's pulled over your head, you can recover from it fairly quickly.
What do we see?
He's already saying the outer arm lock, he'll break his arm. He's going to snap his arm. He did, too.
Wow.
Is that broken?
Yeah, I think he did. That was quick. Doesn't matter. If you're on the bottom, they love being on the bottom. It does not matter.
They fooled you once again, didn't it, Brian?
Yeah. I'll tell you, the acrobatics there was as acrobatic as I've seen all the Gracies. That was about how long a match
you
was.
You thought you were looking at something.
Yeah, I really thought I was seeing a reversal. I think so was the crowd.
No. Can't wrestle with a snake.
And right now we advance to the semifinals. The semifinal brackets are set. You have Smith against Rhodes. Patrick Smith's been there before. Rhodes has simply astounded us at 39 years old. Then you have Pardoe Remco against a man that didn't, well, we thought would be there, but Remco did not think he'd be there as he takes on Hoyce Gracie. So those are the brackets for the semifinals. And this moves right through. Hard to believe a short time ago, we had 16 fighters involved.
It's going very quickly. However, there were some long fights, and I think the guys who've been in there longest time are going to pay the price.
Yeah, I think they're going to be paying the price. Again, another element to factor into this. They don't come back next week. They don't come back tomorrow. They come back tonight. So after they win, the trick is to win, and to win as easy as possible. All right, now it's time to take a look at the disciplines as usual. So as we move to the semifinals, let's do it. Let's take a look at the disciplines and as they oppose each other. Karate will face some kickboxing. Patrick Smith against Johnny Rhodes. And right now is Patrick Smith making his way to the octagon for the second time tonight, third time overall. Patrick Smith, I think it's too narrow of a focus to call him a kickboxer, isn't it, Ben?
Definitely. He's a very all-around fighter now. Very guys. Really came. He brought everything tonight. He's a complete champion. There's not much to say about him. You've seen him here display his talent.
Yeah, he's definitely got a air about him. He's definitely got a charisma about him.
So you believe Smith is going to win?
I'm not making any predictions. I'm not in the prediction.
I will.
Are you?
I am.
I'll tell you, Johnny Rhodes, if he's not tired, he's not human.
If he wins, he's not
human. Time to get a better look at Patrick Smith.
Patrick Smith is often called the uncrowned king of kickboxing. With over 200 full contact victories to his credit, the title is well deserved. He is the 1993 Sabaki Challenge heavyweight champ. A native of Denver, Colorado, Patrick enters the octagon tonight as a hometown favorite. Last November, Patrick lost an action-packed match to shoot fighter Ken Shamrock. He says the experience taught him a lot.
We learned something that night about ankle locks with shoot fighters. And we didn't prepare for him at all right. And now I know how to get out of him.
Patrick moves like a panther in the ring, stalking his prey with power and grace. With Patrick Smith in the octagon, anything can happen.
And anything might happen, anything will happen, because Johnny Rhodes has won two matches to advance to here. It's hard to find a weakness in this man. And he comes into the ring for the third time, and I think it's within 45 minutes. And what could be going through his mind? How long is that first match? Was that 15 minutes, the first match?
I think it was very impressive. I don't know where he got that second win, but I think he surprised us in his second fight.
Longest match in the history of the Ultimate 10.
Unbelievable. Yeah. He came back very impressive.
You know, and you talk about Johnny Rhodes, you talk about a guy that does have that killer instinct because he does know how to win.
He's really
a great guy, he's a true sportsman, but he wants to win. And
nice
right now it's time
man.
To go to Rich Goins so we can start the semifinal.
Ladies and gentlemen, our first semifinal match of the evening in the Ultimate Fighting Championships part two. Please welcome the competitors. First in the blue corner from Las Vegas, Nevada, a fourth degree black belt in Shorinji Ryu Karate, the winner of dozens of national karate championships, and the former Nevada State heavyweight kickboxing champion, 6 foot, 210 pound, Johnny Rhodes. Rhodes. And his opponent, out of the fighting city of Denver, Colorado, in the red corner, a black belt in Taekwondo, Tang Sudo Hapkido, 6'2", 219 pound, Patrick Smith.
He's pumped coming off that last fight.
Yeah, he is coming up that last fight. And I wonder what Johnny Rhodes is thinking. He saw how brutal and how relentless Patrick Smith was.
It's going to be tough. He's going to have to use his leverage, Johnny Rhodes, to have any kind of chance here, I think. I don't think at this point Patrick Smith thinks he can be beaten.
I know he doesn't. Oh, that's the first spin kick I think we've seen.
It's that counter right hand that hurt the other person.
Keep
fighting.
In mind, when it comes to boxing, Pat Smith is a pro boxer. He's undefeated as a pro boxer. Hard to imagine, isn't it?
Johnny has a good right hand going for him, too. And watch how Johnny throws that lead round kick, and then Patrick just lifts his leg in defense.
And this is the closest to a boxing match we've seen.
Yes, it is. He's going to go for the guillotine here, too. He'll lift him up and choke him out. This fight's going to be over.
If so, that would be the first time.
It's going to be over real quick. He's out. He's out. A little cocky.
Smith wins in 45 seconds. A man that fought over 25 minutes tonight looks so invincible. Patrick Smith makes it look easy.
He did it right. He did it right. How he lifted him up when he had the elbow, the blade of the elbow underneath the neck and lifted him up in the guillotine. It's a deadly technique. A
lot of confidence.
Jim, what about the element of confidence, and when can it hurt you? When can it be overconfidence?
When you get with Gracie.
I tell you, I'm going to look up overconfidence in the dictionary. I'm going to be curious to see what's there.
Jim's picture, I think.
Yeah.
My man.
Got to go.
I'm going to take a replay of this. Pat Smith's so dangerous. He's unpredictable. I don't know how he's going to win, but we just are pretty convinced he wins.
Johnny Rhodes goes right into this position by tucking so low right there. And Pat, excuse me.
So how many
Pat
times?
Pat did this earlier.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, we've gone through what, a jug of water here? How much have we been talking? I feel like we've been fighting ourselves. Right there, you see the submission chokehold right before he went on.
Absolutely. I didn't know it could be done with the foot. He tapped out with the foot.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did.
You'll tap out with anything. Right there, tries. He misses the headbutt. It'll go in and lock him up.
The best time and the best place to tap is on the person who's applying the choke.
Because
if you tap on the ground, they can't see you.
Oh,
so
yeah.
You want to tap on that person.
I'll tap on everything.
Now it's time to take a look at a man and get to meet a man and talk about how he feels about going to the finals for the first time at Ultimate Fighting 2. And let's go to Herb, who's with Patrick Smith.
All right, we're here with Patrick. Patrick, that was a terrific fight. All your fights have been short. Why is that?
Easy opponents.
Is it because you got
the number one shoot fighter to beat me last time?
That's good. That's right. But you got the crowd behind you here. You're a hometown favorite. You intend
redemption. I got to redeem myself from last time. Took the number one shoot fighter to beat me. He got me an ankle lock. I didn't know how to get out. This is what I thought I was really best at, a stand-up aggression. Now I'm getting good at ground fighting and chokes, standing up. No one can really take me down yet. The one guy tried to take me down, I stopped before the ref even told me.
Well, it seems like you're doing it upstairs, you're doing it downstairs. You're on the mat, you're upstairs, you're downstairs, so now you got your next match. What do you think about that?
I'm ready to get it over with. I'm ready. I'm still energized. I'm in excellent shape. Thanks to Shane, Jimmy, and Omar. They've been running with me. Get me prepared. I've been boxing a lot in Vegas. For all y'all in Vegas, what's up? Come be back up there next month.
All right, well, keep that crowd going, and good luck in your next match.
Yeah, you'll come back to another replay and see why he's so confident that he would excel in this tournament, because he's so dangerous so many different ways.
Watch how this blade goes underneath the neck. He uses his leverage. He just stands up and leans back.
How do you break that, Ben?
It's very difficult. The first thing you have to do is reach up underneath, grab that arm that's choking you, and put your weight on.
Okay, tell Johnny that. Is he still in the arena?
Johnny right now is wondering why there's a date on sour cream.
There are too many things to learn for a fight like this. You know what I mean?
You don't do it overnight. Yeah, this is years and years of perfected
years
talent.
Years and years, absolutely.
Definitely.
I really want to give credit to Johnny Rose, because he entertained us all and he shocked many, many people by his endurance and his great showing at 39 years old.
I agree with you, Brian.
Yeah, right now a shot of the ring girls who have been entertaining the crowd, keeping everyone busy in between bouts as we come to you live around the nation. Time for the next semifinal, and let's go to the disciplines first. This will feature grappling, a discipline of grappling we've seen quite a lot, very successfully, I imagine. Grappling takes on grappling. Fighters most likely are very comfortable on their backs, and right now it's time to go to Remco Pardue. And let's go to Remco, who's preparing to walk through the smoke for the third time tonight with his whole Dutch entourage.
They're all here. Oh, he really surprised us last time.
He really did.
When he beat Orlando Veit, unbelievable technique that he used.
With the reverse psychologist saying that he thought he was going to lose.
Correct.
That is something new.
Yeah, you know, but you said it. You thought he was the only honest guy here.
And right now, he's going to be honest in this fight.
Yes, he is.
If he says.
Yes, he
what?
Yeah. I mean, he's got to be satisfied to it that he got here at all. He's only going to improve, just 24 years old. Now it's time to take a look at a man that's won this event before. He won Ultimate Fighting 1. His name is Hoyce Gracie. He's about 28, 29 years old, and he's very focused on winning this semifinal bracket. Let's take a look at Hoyce as he makes his way through the smoke with the whole Gracie entourage. All of them dangerous in their own right. All of them very prideful of their family and their technique and their discipline. You know that. You know that very well, Ben.
Yes, for Remco to do the same thing that he did before, he'll only have 1 or 2 seconds at most to apply any kind of elbow strike like he did before, because Hoyce is not going to stand for that.
Yeah, Hoyce makes his way into the ring. Tell us that about his name again. You said all their names are unique, all the Gracies?
All of their names begin with R, and they're very unique names, and it's pronounced Hoyce, H. The R's are H's. It's Portuguese from Brazil.
Yeah, but taking a shot at his family in the crowd.
All of those Gracies are deadly.
Hey,
trust
Jim,
me.
They
the one drinking
family,
the Coca-Cola right now,
well, they represent.
You don't want it.
They represent the epitome of family love. I love it.
They really do. And let's take a look at this semifinal bracket, and let's look at the tail of the tape. Hoyce Gracie, as we know, 6'1", 176, kind of light, slight, but quick. Remco Pardue, 6'4", 260, but very sleek, very confident, and he's a growing boy. And now it's time to go to the ring announcer, the G-Man, doing a great job all night. Take us through the semifinals.
Ladies and gentlemen, our second semifinal of the evening. Please welcome back the competitors. First, fighting out of the red corner, from Os Holland, the current owner of the Dutch, Belgium, German, and Danish Open Class Jiu-Jitsu Championships, 6'4", 260 pounds, Remco Pardue. And please welcome back once again out of the blue corner, the defending Ultimate Fighting champion from Rio de Janeiro, a master in the art of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, 6'1", 176 pound, Hoyce Gracie.
That's Hoyce's look.
Yeah, as the Gracies get more acclimated into the American culture and people learn more about them, I look for them to take a much easier path towards fame. Because this guy, that face, I mean, this guy should be in the movies, Jim.
Oh, he is in the movies.
Yeah. Oh, this is very real.
I think Hoyce will try to end this quickly because of the altitude. He doesn't want a long fight. And if Remco exposes his arm as he did in the other two fights, I think it's going to...
Why look at the eyes? Why do the eyes give away what he'll do?
Because he doesn't want him to think that he's going to shoot low, so he keeps everything high. He'll fake high with his hands. He'll raise his hands above. Watch. Just a second, he'll just lift his hands up. They'll go up a little bit higher, and then he'll shoot. He'll take him down just like that. He puts all of his weight on him so that Remco tires out. He's just sitting down.
Well?
He's just sitting down right now. He'll hook him. He'll hook him. He'll take him down.
Is Remco resisting well?
Yes, he is. Yes, he is. It's just a matter of time.
He'll go for the choke right away. He'll get his left hand out. He's going to pry it out. And if he grabs his hand, see his left hand, he goes over the back. Remco should tuck his chin in here to keep that. Now Hoist can choke him out with his gi. He can choke him out with his gi right here. See, Hoist has his gi, has him by the gi.
Yeah.
He can choke him out just
and
like this.
And keep in mind, both these fighters are reasonably, reasonably fresh.
He has the gi. Hoist doesn't see. Hoist doesn't see that the gi is on the chin.
Oh, he doesn't.
He's got to pull his head up.
Who?
Hoist has to. He's looking now. He has to pull Remco's head up to get the gi underneath the chin.
And well, how can the gi do that? Just work as a...
Yes.
A weapon.
Oh, absolutely. But he still doesn't know. He still doesn't see it.
How's Remco doing?
Remco's fine. I think he's, I don't know, unless the pain here, unless he gets enough of it around.
He looks like he's in tremendous
pain.
Yeah,
he's tapped out.
He's tapped out. And the Gracies, Royce Gracie's in the finals one more time.
Yes,
sir. What a final.
Pat Smith.
Never have planned it.
Royce Gracie, I'll tell you. Remco has nothing to be ashamed about. He did tremendous.
Unbelievable.
And a man just entered the ring to soothe Remco that lost to Gracie in the finals. He looks like there's words. Oh, he said, come back.
Yes.
Okay.
Remco said that would be the biggest fear is running into Hoist. It's what he was most nervous about. And I know that Hoist wasn't making sense to him. He had the pressure. Any man would have gone down. He just didn't see it hooked over his chin. And Hoist kept looking around. He still couldn't see because his chin was tucked.
That was about your 1,000th great observation, Ben.
Yeah, he's had a great night as well.
Yes, sir, my man.
Hey, let's take a look at the replay. Just tapping out. It's over. And you were saying that, Ben, you didn't think the lock was in securely?
Well, I knew the arm lock was. The arm was not secure around the neck, so I knew when he was reaching for the gi because he kept tucking his chin, that was how he was going to choke him out because they will choke you out with the gi each time.
Okay.
Jim knows that.
And this is what I'm talking about.
It's unbelievable.
Yes.
All week long, they respect each other, get to know each other, and then at the end, they make sure to greet each other.
You know, Remco is going to go home a very proud man. To get as far as he did tonight against these competitors is unbelievable.
Now
a lot of respect for him.
Now I believe Hoist when he says that fight, the size doesn't matter.
No.
It has nothing to do with winning and losing.
His theory.
He rode him like an elephant, man.
Yes, he did.
Yeah, he did.
He also says their theory, the Gracie theory is if you're in a swimming pool, Jim, how much do you weigh?
About 250.
That's big man. I weigh 148. If we're in a swimming pool at the same time, we're the same size. That's their theory on the ground.
How big would I be in the swimming pool?
Big man.
Pretty big.
Oh, yeah, you'd be big.
I'd be big?
Big
yes,
man.
Big.
Jim, we'll talk about that later.
Guys.
Yeah.
You know, it's very interesting. There's one man in this country in Ultimate Fighting Championship that fought both men, and it is Ken Shamrock. Ken Shamrock fought the Gracie. That's how he got eliminated early on.
Tough
he
man.
Beat Patrick Smith. He broke his hand. He wasn't able to compete. You saw him before. I think it's important we go to Ken Shamrock right now, who's with Herb. Herb?
Great. Okay, we're back here with Ken Shamrock. Ken, what do you think about it so far?
Let me tell you, you have to take a breather when you're watching all this. You know, there's a lot more more competitors. You know, there's 16 of them this time. Last time there was 8. So you got a lot more going on. I think the level is kind of bumped up a bit here. You know, you got Rimpelpart. He was impressive. I was really impressed with him. You know, he gets a little more practice in there with some submission and learning some of the Gracie's chokeholds and things like that. I think he's going to be a power or a force to reckon with. Patrick Smith, you know, he's a changed man. I see him doing a lot of things here. I don't think, you know, that he has the grappling ability to beat Hoist in the finals, but Hoist is going to have to work. He's going to have to take the punches away. He's going to have to take to the ground and keep Patrick from getting on top because Patrick is strong and he could throw a punch.
You know, I got your list of predictions in my pocket. You made some predictions. They're looking pretty good so far.
Well, you know, I picked Patrick Smith and I picked Hoist to be in the finals, and here they are. You know, along the way, some of the guys got bumped off, but the same are there, you know.
Okay, you got $50,000. Who's this going on?
Who's it going to?
Who's it going on?
Oh, Hoist, all the way, baby. I want him to win because I want to see him in Japan. You know, it's, I want to come back and show what I have. And last time, I got in here a little nervous, didn't prepare properly. And Hoist is an outstanding grappler on the ground. And I'm going to have to be at my top game to beat him, and I plan to be there.
So if you had a plan for this, what would you plan? How would you beat Hoist next time?
It's a secret.
Talk about the guy Patrick Smith, who's now in the finals. Ken Shamrock knows this quite well, straight up, that Patrick Smith has learned to grapple. He says he worked on grappling. That means a lot to me. It might mean a lot to Jim, but Ben, you know what it takes to be superior in grappling. Can you learn enough in 6 months to be effective?
You can be very effective in 6 months. The best way to teach someone nothing is show them everything.
So if you can take this step by step and really get it into your computer bank, put it on the hard disk, if you will, you can definitely be a force in 6 months.
Yeah.
It's easy to learn. Very easy.
You can be a force against someone that's done it all their lives.
Oh, absolutely.
Really?
Oh, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. You have an aptitude for it. Patrick Smith against Royce Gracie. That'll be our final matchup, Jim. All right, now it's time to take a look at the disciplines and the fighters behind them. But first, let's look at it. Kickboxing takes on grappling. That's Gracie Jiu-Jitsu, and that's Patrick Smith they talk about. And right now, Patrick Smith does something he's done three times, four times in all. Patrick Smith away can make his way into the ring through the smoke. Let's see if he's as relaxed as he has been in bouts past. Patrick Smith makes his way through, talking to the crowd. This is his hometown, after all.
True deserving champion to make it this far, Brian. Everyone in the whole arena, they're on their feet, giving him a standing ovation for this final bout.
Is he as relaxed as he looks, Jim, in your estimation?
It looks a little different this time, I think. I think he's going to be all business.
Patrick Smith has gotten it home quite well. He's got a great future in so many different aspects, so many different arts, so many different disciplines. He'll make his way into the ring and take out a guy he didn't get an opportunity to face in UFC 1, and that is Royce Gracie. He not only fights Royce Gracie, he fights Gracie Jiu-Jitsu. And it should be very interesting because I have not seen Pat on his back. I have not seen him grapple yet, but he says that he's done a lot of work in that area, and he certainly will be tested right now. Patrick Smith makes his way in, talks to his corner, gets some final thoughts, but it's really too late now. That's a finished package.
There are several people who picked Patrick Smith to make it to the final, Ken Shamrock being one. Ken's a true champion. What a great guy. Ken actually has he's a comic strip character in Japan. So
is he
that's
really?
Gonna, yeah.
Yeah. And here's a guy that is a real-life character here. He's making his way into the ring. In front of him is the whole Gracie family. He is Royce Gracie, the defending champion. And he's going to get his chance to defend his title right now. This will be his fourth match tonight. And he takes on Patrick Smith, the man, as I mentioned, he has not faced. His concentration is quite evident. His family's concentration is quite evident. Patrick Smith just taking water on in the corner. He knows he's facing a champion. He knows he's facing something he's never seen.
Even though Royce has spent more time tonight in the ring, he exerts less energy than Patrick has ever.
Have they looked at the films, guys? Does he know what Patrick Smith will do?
I think so, of course.
All right.
Royce really doesn't care.
I'll tell you, let's take an up-close look at our defending champion, Royce Gracie.
When Royce Gracie steps into the octagon, he brings 65 years of tradition with him. That's how long the Gracie family has been undefeated in no-holds-barred competition.
All my brothers practice smoke. And my father, we all practice this all our lives. This is part of our life.
A native of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, he is a fourth-degree black belt in the art of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. At last year's competition, Royce swept through a field of top fighters to win the title of Ultimate Fighting Champion. And how does Royce prepare for this event?
Well, in an event like this, preparing myself, with my brothers and my father around, with the technique that we have and with them on my corner, they know, they trust me, and they make me believe that I'll do it. The winning team, we don't change. That's what we say in Brazil.
No matter who he faces tonight, Royce Gracie is ready.
You put the devil on the other side, I'm gonna walk into fight.
It's finally going to happen, guys. We're finally going to get the finals and all the tension, everything from WOW Productions to Semaphore Productions. They got to feel good about this. The crowd is here, and let's go to Rich Goins for the
ladies and gentlemen, the city of Denver, Colorado welcomes the world to the finals of the Ultimate Fighting Championships Part 2. Once again, there are no rules. The winner will take home $60,000. Please welcome the contestants returning from Rio de Janeiro, the fourth degree master of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. 27 years old, last year's Ultimate Fighting Champion. Please welcome back Royce Gracie. Gracie. And his opponent, a black belt in taekwondo, Tang Sudo Hapkido, 6'2", 220 pounds, from the fighting city of Denver, Colorado, Patrick Smith.
Patrick Smith, Redemption 94 on his shorts. He has certainly redeemed himself. It all ends right here. And he has a very cordial attitude this time. Do you notice?
This is what everyone wanted to see.
Patrick Smith, Royce Gracie, it's about to happen. Royce's longest fight was just over 4 minutes. Let's see how long this goes. Let's see who comes up on top.
Royce is in no hurry right now, as he was in the earlier bout, I can assure you. Because this is the final bout. So he's not going to do anything different than his normal strategy now. I think Patrick will probably try to kick, try to knee, and be very careful to go to the ground. This is what Hoist wants.
There's
now Hoist will stand to the side so Patrick cannot knee him in the groin. Watch this, he cannot do it. Hoist will now try to get unlocked from that right leg of Patrick. Patrick has him locked in that leg. That doesn't matter. Hoist will try to unlock this. You see
him doing that now. He's trying to push.
He did. Now he's in a man of position. It's just a matter of time. He will palm strike him. Patrick will turn over. Hoist will go to a choke.
Patrick's looking at, he's looking at the referee.
This is where Hoist wants to be. His head is very close, so there.
Patrick has not been on the ground.
That's correct.
All night.
This is not a good position for Patrick to be in.
How does Patrick get out of this, Ben?
It's very different. He has to hook his foot on Hoist's foot and then turn him over.
He's taking a pounding.
Yes, he is. This is, the towel is in already. Patrick will not like this. He will not like this. Hoist is the ruler. He is the greatest champion on the planet right now. Yes,
he did accept it.
Unbelievable.
Those blows were devastating.
He is the Ultimate Fighting Champion. Two consecutive times, two events. They both really respect each other.
Absolutely.
That is a wonderful sight.
Yes, it is.
And I'll tell you, I think Patrick, I didn't see the Gracies cut anybody since they've been there.
Watch the Gracies come in and congratulate Patrick Smith. Watch this, look at this. They're all champions. They're all wonderful human beings. That's a wonderful sight.
It was 1 minute, 13 seconds. It was the second longest match for Gracie tonight.
Just because it was only that short does not mean they were not the ultimate champions fighting against each other.
That's why.
And there is Hoist. He's $60,000 richer.
Yes.
He's a happy man. And Jimmy was blaming Uncle Sam last time. They said he took all his winning money.
Went to Disneyland.
Yeah. I guess he'll go to Knott's Berry Farm and Magic Mountain now.
Well, I guess the guys better work harder. A little harder.
You're going to see it's going to get tougher and tougher,
guys.
I told
you about that 6 months stuff, man. 6 months cannot deal with a lifetime of training, 65 years. The Gracie family.
That's absolutely true, Jim. Unbelievable.
Hoist has a small cut over his eye. I guess it's not going to bother him much tonight. He has a lot of celebrating to do. It was incredible, and I'll tell you, he's much more confident. The whole family is in the ring. They knew it was a much tougher journey this time.
It really was.
It was a wonderful tournament.
Hey, Brian, when you're good, you don't have to be violent.
That's true. The technique
almost takes the violence out of it.
That's absolutely right.
That's a great point.
Every one of Hoist's opponents tonight, We're not putting any serious injury.
Yes.
That says a lot for his style.
And you're seeing some great photos right now. Hoist being held up by a bunch of people that are champions in their own right, each and every one of them. And they're happy for their brother. They're happy for the father. Imagine that father, what he feels like. His technique is the reason why Hoist is there today.
This was his dream.
Let's take a look at the replay. This is how he became UFC champion number two.
Now what Hoist is doing right now, he's in a mounted position. He will let him roll over. He will get him in a position where he cannot move, and he will literally start pummeling him. This is fine. He'll get his left arm up. He's hitting him now. His left arm goes to the face, and Hoist just now has all the leverage. He's locked in. His right foot is against his body so that Patrick cannot move.
Unbelievable, because just when you think of Gracie as maybe they're breaking free from a hold, they're playing right into their hands.
They really do. And that, when I say mounted position, you saw other mounted positions tonight from other fighters, but Gracie's mounted position is a little bit different. They throw about three or four different elements into it.
And right now, let's go to the check. This is what it's all for. Hoist knows it, $60,000. Let's go to a look right now, guys.
Here it is.
Of what it took to win.
Watch his right foot is just hooked up against his body. He can't move.
Are those normal punches? Over. Are they?
They're standard punches, but he's hitting with these two knuckles only, and he's going right to the face. Towel comes in. They stop the fight. It was a wise move. He would have choked him out.
And it was good because Patrick Smith in the last one complained after he lost to Ken Shamrock. The ankle lock knocked him out. He got up and wanted off of Ken Shamrock, this time more of a sportsman.
No one likes to lose to a foot lock.
And let's go to Herb Perez with the champion, Hoyce Gracie.
Hoyce, it was a wonderful match. You did a terrific job again. You did it twice. You're the ultimate warrior once again, the ultimate champion. What do you think about that?
Excuse me?
What do you think about that? You're the ultimate champion once again.
I'll be back to do it again September.
Was it hard?
It is. All is hard. It's all is hard. They're all tough guys. They're all very good in what they're doing. But it's jiu-jitsu all the way.
Did you do anything different this time to prepare for your match? Was there any special training? Were you worried about anyone?
This is my special train over here. Those guys are. Those guys over here. That's my special training.
So once again, Gracie Jiu-Jitsu has won the Ultimate Fighting Championship for the second time. You think you'll have any more difficulty with the next one?
We'll see. Can't wait.
Last time you said you're going to Disneyland. Where are you going this time?
I'm gonna go skiing. I'm gonna go rest a little bit and get ready for the next one.
Seems like you got a lot of people to buy dinner for.
The next ones, I hope they have some more tough guys, more good guys that claim to be tough out there. And I want them to show up. This being here was mean tough. You see a lot of guys in the magazine saying they're toughs, but they don't show up on the ring.
Once again, I think you've proved that you are the ultimate champion. You've beaten everybody. Anybody that would come here, you've beaten. And it looks like you're going to do it from now until forever. Congratulations on a wonderful championship.
I'll be doing this until them take my place. When they get their turn, I'll retire.
Yeah, I'll tell you, I've had a great time tonight, and so many people who don't get seen behind the scenes did such a tremendous job sweating in the truck, although they do get catered food. They had a great time and worked so hard. As much as Hoyce was a champion tonight, everyone that made this possible, including the audience here, were champions in their own right.
Well, I enjoyed working with both of you.
Thank you, guys. I enjoyed you, Jim. Brian, it was a wonderful night, powerful deal. I'm glad.
For everyone for WOW, for everyone from Semaphore, I'm Brian Kilmeade, Jim Brown, Ben. Hopefully we can hang out tonight and forever and possibly even in
Looking
Japan
forward
again.
To it.
Have a great night, everyone, and thanks for tuning in to the Ultimate Fighting Championship 2, the sequel, There'll Be Another.
Congratulations, Hoyce. Thanks.